Welcome back to this episode of Money Talk. And here we have with us a very special guest. He is the author of the blog No Money La, Chin Yi Xuan.
Yes, hi everyone. It's great to be here.
Right. So Yi Xuan, you want to introduce a little bit about yourself?
Okay, sure. I'm Yi Xuan and I'm the founder or author of the blog NoManila.com. So laugh with the H, L-A-H, NoManila.com. So I write things about personal finance, investment, like and life, and one part of the things that I focus on is real estate investment trust. Yes. Mm.
Yeah. So one of the things that No Money La is very popular for is the fact that they are quite focused on REITs,
yes.
Right? Real estate investment trust. But one thing before we begin and go into the topic of REITs, right? I just want to ask you one thing. Why did you put taking adulthood head on as part of your main tagline in No Money La? I really love that, though.
No? Yeah. Thanks. No Money La was started with when I just graduated from university. So basically, it's the official step into the adulthood life. So I thought this blog should be something that's representative of me learning from and learning from my adulthood journey and some of the experience and lessons about my adulthood journey as well. So I could empower more people to live a more meaningful.
Right, I love that. Yeah, I actually want to prove that about being an adult is to learn how to take care of your own finance.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. Money is a very, very important and crucial part of
adulthood.
Yes, exactly.
Yes, agree, totally agree. Exactly. I love that, yeah. So Yi Xuan, one of the things is this. How did you actually got involved in real estate investment?
I started, or let's just say I got to know about real estate investment trust or in short REITs when I was in university. I was just done with this student club and I thought to myself, hey, what should I should think about my future and stuff like that. I got to know about real estate. I got started to get to know about investing. I thought, is there like something in between? And that's how I got to know real estate investment trust. Yes.
I see. So you just finished a leadership role in some school club.
Yes.
And then after that, you just started thinking about what do you want to do with life or whatsoever.
Exactly.
That kind of thing, right? Yeah. So what? How come the first thing, right, when you think about what to do next is think about investment? People will be thinking about like a career, like what kind of job I want to do or something like that, right? But what got you into like straight away, okay, I think I want to learn about investment.
True enough, I think it's fair to say that career is part of the consideration or something to think about after, let's say, after an important year of university, so towards graduation. So for me, career is one of them, but investment, learning how to invest is definitely one of them as well, because we are millennials, right? I think we want to learn. We want to achieve financial freedom. That's a dream, that's a goal. So investment is definitely part of the consideration, that's no doubt.
Right, right, yeah. So I think that's actually very smart because at the end of the day, the truth is career is one thing, but learning how to manage your finance and learning how to invest yourself is where it's going to lead you to financial freedom.
Exactly.
Yeah, career just gives you that means to give you the money to do something about it.
Exactly.
Yeah, and I think that's pretty smart. I hope during my uni time I was like that, but unfortunately during my uni days, I didn't actually even thought about investment. My life was in uni just enjoying myself, hanging out with friends. Yeah, only by the time it was near graduation that I decided that, okay, I need to start thinking about what kind of job to look for. Yeah. So, when you started, is that the first investment that you thought about, real estate investment trust? Is that the first thing you got started with?
To be honest, not really. My first investment into something, anything at all, was actually gold. It was I actually invested in gold before I entered university, but that was on the context that I do not know anything about investing during that time, so I thought, okay, gold is the simplest thing to do. I just open an account and just put my money in. And yeah, so the first thing was not REITs, actually it was gold.
Okay. So only after that then you learn about, so the second investment only is REITs?
It was into like normal stocks or shares,
normal stocks.
Then and only then into REITs. Americas.
Right, right. So what do you love about REITs that made you decide to like kind of dedicate even your focus on it, and even you actually teach workshops about how to invest in REITs. So what about REITs that got you to love it so much?
Yeah, so first of all, right, I consider myself I'm only here to share what I know about REITs for my workshop, what I like about REITs, there are three particular reasons. So first of all, it pays great dividends. So in Malaysia, they pay around 5 to 6 percent in average for dividends.
Yep.
So it's great for long-term investment. Secondly, it's a simple business model. If you read some of my articles about REITs, right, it's not REIT. You know that REITs or understanding REITs is not rocket science. It's just a very simple, straightforward business model which everyone can understand if they want to learn or if they put enough effort inside. So simple business model is done. And number three is it is a great source of side or passive income supplements. Yes.
I see. Yeah. So maybe for some of the viewers here, right, they may not be too clear of what REITs is or how it works. So just like since you were mentioning about simple business model, maybe do you want to explain to them what REITs actually is and what is the business model like?
In very, very simple explanation or description, real estate investment trusts or REITs, right? They are companies that owns business real estates. You could have known about Sunway Pyramid, you could have known about shopping malls like The Guardians, Mid Valley. So these are companies that owns and operates this kind of businesses, and the way they earn money is through collecting rent from their tenants. Mm-hmm. So this is basically all REITs operate in a very similar general business model, and this makes REITs a very, very simple business to understand.
Yeah, actually I love the fact, one thing about REITs is that for those of you, REITs is basically they take people's money and then they buy property and then they collect rent from it, and then with the rent, they give you back the profit, most of it. Yes. Yeah, that's generally an idea. So in Chinese, we call it bao zhou gong.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's just like in a way bigger scale, right?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, so like the whole pavilion, you know, and stuff like that, right? So zhou ge bao zhou gong, okay?
Right.
So that's definitely one of my hobby and something that I aspire to be.
Yes, that's something.
I personally didn't start off with REITs investment. I started off by buying property straight, and I bought a couple of it, and then I rented it out. But along the way, I am now starting to invest in REITs because the fact that I feel that it's a lot more liquid. Because properties that I rented out to people, when they don't rent it during the period, I have to pay the money to support the property, and if there's any problem, leakages or whatsoever, like recently one of my property actually had a leakage. Yeah.
Okay.
So although it's under management, but it's still very troublesome for me.
Exactly.
Yeah. But when it comes to REITs, I have no such worry. Yeah. At the end of the day, actually, when I calculated my returns and everything, I feel that on a yearly basis, in fact, REITs offer me similar or even more return on a yearly basis.
Exactly. And you do not have to worry about all the micro issues like the maintenance and stuff like that.
Correct. Yeah. And so that's what made me start to be more interested and decided to actually put my money in REITs. But there's also the other side of it, is that the capital increase of the property, if you buy a physical property, there is a higher chance of it having a much better capital increase. Mm-hmm. Compared to REITs, the prices tend to be a lot more stable, right? Yeah. So, yeah, but I guess it's kind of like you kind of everything perfect, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. One is in exchange for a more worry-free and stable income, and the other one is kind of like hopefully it's like it makes it one day kind of thing, right? Okay. Anyway, many people have been talking about lately. So one of the reasons why I actually brought Yishun here today is because we have been talking about recession since last year.
Oh yeah, this is the 10th year since the Great Recession. It's very interesting.
Yes, and many economists are talking about this year is going to be a recession, either next year is going to be a recession. Last year there was this yield curve inversion thing, and all these kind of things have been pointing to the fact that there is going to be a very big recession. Yeah, how big is it going to be? We all do not know. And how will it come? Is it going to be in the form that it hit us before we even realize? Also, we do not know. Is it going to be a very short period, a long period? No one knows. But one thing for sure is this. When times are getting like that and volatile and recession hits, many people start looking for defensive instrument to invest in.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And there are a few defensive ones that y'all will know is, they say gold, one thing. Yeah. And number two is actually property investments. And therefore, REITs is where it comes into play. Yeah. So many people right now are saying that during this recession period, REITs is bound to grow. REITs is bound to do well because people are afraid, so people are flocking to REITs. What do you think about that?
To be honest, I can't tell for sure if the our REITs in Malaysia would stand the next recession. I think no one can tell that for sure. But if you have written my check out my articles, I do write about there are a few kinds of REITs in the market. It's not just like the Summit Pyramid Mid-Valley kind of REITs. We call them the retail REITs. So retail REITs, you know, are just like any other business. For sure, during the recession, no one gonna spend, no one gonna buy. So REITs like this definitely gonna get impacted. But there are one kind of REITs that is very defensive, or they are considered defensive in this kind of situation, which is what we call the healthcare REITs. So this kind of REITs are the REITs that owns healthcare facilities or clinics or hospitals. So regardless of the market situation, people can get sick, right?
Yes.
So in this kind of situation, people still need healthcare. So in a very recession or market downfall point of view, normally healthcare or any healthcare related business is gonna be very defensive.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. True. Yeah. In fact, the truth is that when it comes to healthcare, I personally am very interested in healthcare REITs. So that's one of the REITs that I am like, starting to accumulate. Yeah. In Malaysia, it will be our car.
Yes.
Right?
That's the only one publicly listed REITs, healthcare REITs in Malaysia. Yes.
So Al-Akar, for those of you who don't know, Al-Akar actually is the REIT that owns most of the KPJ hospitals,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Other than KPJ, anything else that they own?
If I'm not wrong, they do own some other little healthcare properties, but those are not quite significant compared to their main holdings of KPJ healthcare facilities.
Yeah, that's their main one, right? And year-on-year basis, they've been increasing their revenue, their profits as well.
Yeah, if I remember correctly, that's the case.
Yeah, not significantly lah, but like, it's been a ladder, decent,
yes.
Very steady climb, that's what I see. I'm not a stock analyst, so
me
I'm not really qualified to make too much of comments, but all these, whatever that we talk about, the stock will be our own personal opinion.
Exactly.
Yeah, so please don't take it as an investment advice and go and buy it, and if you lose money, and count it on us, yeah? Yeah, so it's nothing to do with us. So nonetheless, just to let you guys know, like what you should say, healthcare REITs is very unique because at the end of the day, whether market is good or market is bad, people are bound to get sick. It's a basic necessity. Yeah, and that's for that reason as well, we can see even companies like Nestle or so on tends to grow even during bad times, because whether market is good, market is bad, you still drink Nescafe.
Mm-hmm. Milo.
Yeah, you still drink Milo, you still buy Maggi Mee. Although there are more replacements.
More people, yeah.
Exactly. Although nowadays there are a little bit more replacement, but still the Malaysian favorite.
Yes.
Yeah, people
yes.
still go for it. But one thing, healthcare is that it's even more harder to change because there's no replacement to healthcare. It's just go and see a doctor and get yourself healed, right? Yeah. So for your opinion right now, you were saying that healthcare REITs is one that you really, really are focusing on at this point?
Not really. Not that I really focus on healthcare. But it is definitely in my watch list to really get prepared in case of any movement in the market. But definitely is healthcare REITs or the business is definitely part of my watch list.
Right. So usually for our car, how many percent of dividend do they give out yearly?
From my last check, they give out a very decent average of 5-6%, which is pretty decent.
Yeah.
It's the average, but it's something that an investor should expect when they invest in REITs.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, and I like the fact that the business model itself is very defensive, so it works well during recession times. And even if the market is good, it's still going to do well because people have more money spare to go for better healthcare.
Yeah.
yeah, again. So other than healthcare REITs, what other REITs are there in the market?
I talk about Mayvalley and Sun Family kind of retail REITs. These are retail REITs and they are healthcare REITs. We have talked about healthcare REITs. There are office REITs that just focus on office. There are hospitality REITs. They don't focus on hospitals, but they focus on on residential buildings and hotels.
Yeah.
Those are hospitality REITs and they are industrial REITs. Those are REITs that focus on warehouses, factories, and last of all, there are something called the mixed REITs. So mixed REITs are something, it's a company that own like different kind of properties. Mm. Yes.
Yeah. Like Sunway is a mixed REITs. Yes. They have retail, they have hotels, they have schools, they have all sorts of stuff.
Exactly.
Right? Yeah. And so what is the pros and cons of the mixed REITs? There's so many different kinds of things.
Basically, maybe I'll just share like a few. So first of all, the good thing is about mixed REITs is definitely you have a very diverse business model. So you have very diverse kind of properties. So you can basically enjoy the advantage brought by each kind of properties. Mm-hmm. So then, but on the other side, on the flip side, I think you are also exposed to all the risks that comes together with the business. So retail have their own risks, hotels they have their own risks, and even healthcare have their own risks. So if you have all these properties together, it comes along with all the risks.
Right, yeah. Right. So it's kind of like while you're safer, you also have more risks.
As I it's a good problem to have because they are quite diverse.
Yeah. So it's like while you have multiple kind of situation can also, you can still make money, it's still good for business, but it's still bad for certain part of the business, right?
Yeah, think about it like this, when this part got hit, the other part of the business will try to support
Are you a fan of mixed REIT yourself?
Definitely, if the business fundamentals is good, if the number seems right, I'm definitely good. I mean, I would definitely go for mixed REITs. Yeah.
Right, right. So what do you mean by the fundamental and the numbers are right?
Basically, during my workshop on a personal note, I do have a certain criteria that must be fulfilled before I decide to invest in any kind of REITs.
Mm.
So regardless of whether it's a retail or mixed REITs, I want to see the numbers. If the numbers are right, then and only then I will consider investing in the REIT.
Right, right. What are some of the ways that we can you can just share with us like maybe one or two things that certain numbers that we should take a look at.
Yeah.
Like because for stock investment we tend to look at PE, we tend to look at PR, growth rate, price to book, stuff like that, right? Is it any too different from REITs?
For REITs specifically, there are from my personal understanding and research and study, there are certain sets of benchmark that needs to be fulfilled, and it could be a little different from normal stock investing or stock filtering process. So for me personally, I want to share two. So first of all, it's definitely gearing ratio. Gearing, for those who are not unclear, is basically you get your total borrowing divided by your total assets. So I look into how they manage their debt, if they are good in managing their borrowings and assets. And also, number one is definitely gearing. So number two is also definitely dividend yield. If the dividend yield is lower than my personal benchmark, I wouldn't waste my time to invest in it.
Right, right. So two things that we can actually take a look at. Number one is gearing ratio. Number two is actually dividend yield.
Yes.
And gearing ratio is actually about how the management company deals with their debt. Are they highly leveraged, as in like they take a lot of debt? Or not. So what I understand about gearing ratio, correct me if I'm wrong, is the fact that if they have too much of loan, then at the end of the day, let's say they really have to chop up, sell down, down, then even if you sell off their asset, you end up using the money to pay loan. So there's nothing left for investors. So it's important to actually have a lower gearing ratio, like not so high.
It's important to have a healthy gearing ratio.
So so one of these things is this. For most people who are not used to investing, they will think that any form of loan is not good, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah. So but actually the truth is that even when it comes to REITs and most of the investment in just stock or whatever, if you have zero gearing, it's actually also not good.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. If you have zero gearing, means you are not expanding your business, like, and it's bad for investors.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So one of the things that most of our investors would assume that if you want to grow your business fast or grow it well, you're going to borrow money and then expand, use it for operation to expand the business. But if, let's say, you're not borrowing any money, it usually means that you are not really doing much to grow your business, lah.
Exactly.
You are just maintaining a status quo, lah.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, same thing with any other kind of stocks or even real estate investment. It's very important to have a healthy gearing ratio.
Yes, exactly.
Do you want to give us a hint of, like, what for you, in your own personal opinion, what is a good gearing ratio for you?
Okay. By law. REIT must maintain a gearing with less than 0.5. It means that whatever your total borrowing is, right, your gearing must be at least your total asset value must be at least two times. It comes to 0.5, right?
Right.
So
if I borrowed 1 million, I should have 2 million in asset.
Exactly, which makes it 0.5. So personally, my personal benchmark is lower than 0.5 for sure. So if my personal benchmark is around 0.4. Yes.
Okay. So I suppose you are more risk averse in that sense when it comes to.
I would say I have a higher filtering benchmark.
You have a higher filtering benchmark, lah.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, so here's where, right, I just want to, before we go into the end, I also want to just share a little bit with you guys. So one thing that Yi Xuan is actually very into, and he's actually an expert in that area, is actually in the area of trading.
Right? Not to say I'm an expert, I'm just I'm quite passionate in this thing of trading.
Yeah, so Yishan is actually into trading, which means that he does day trading, right? By himself within the day, and you trade in...
The way I trade applies to any kind of instrument. It could be ETF, it could be index, it could be futures, it could be currency, it could be stocks as well.
Yeah, so you see, one thing why I want to say that, right, is when we talk about risk, many people actually think that if I'm low risk, then, so therefore, I will like, oh, my gearing should be 0.4, I've got no risk. But actually, it's not like that. Something I think a lot of people do not understand is that when they assess their risk, they need to take a whole portfolio into account. Like, for example, for Yishan, I'm not sure about you, but probably because you know what instrument are you dealing with. Like, for example, when you're doing trading, those are slightly more higher risk already. So when you're investing in REITs, what you want is a guarantee. You want something that's safer, so therefore you may actually set a standard like, okay, I'm more strict towards that. I want this to be 0.4 because I want to have a margin of safety like that. But there are also other areas that you are more adventurous with, right?
In a way, but personally, I would consider, I would say whatever you do, whether it's investing or trading, you need to understand your risk. When you understand what you are doing, when you understand the risk that you are willing to take, regardless whether it's a long-term investment like this or short-term trading into stocks, it's no different, right? You just need to know what you are doing and you will be safer that way. Yeah.
Yes. So the point I want to say is that, like, mostly for us as an individual when we talk about investment, right, we need to have our overall portfolio as an overview, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like, for example, I myself, I'm quite highly geared in the sense where I like quite a few properties, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. So, because I already have one area that's pretty high risk, then I will have certain instruments that I'm investing in that are very low risk as well. Yeah. And then I will have certain instruments that are more towards the medium risk. So having a more diversified portfolio.
Exactly.
Like, actually, I do invest in traders,
yeah,
which means like copy trading, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, there are traders who trade and we just
exactly.
Pump our money in, right? It's quite common actually.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And those are very high risk. I can just lose like 5-10% within a month.
Exactly.
But I can also make like 5-10% within a month. Right? And so I have that one very small portion of my money that goes into that, and now I'm looking at another smaller portion into crypto.
Mm-hmm.
So the one's another topic altogether.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I think REITs for me is something right now that plays a role in stabilizing that thing if there's a rough time.
Yeah, so you are right, Peter, definitely you are right. So as an example, if you are holding a lot of your portfolio is pretty aggressive, REITs is definitely something that could help smoothen the aggressiveness.
Yeah. So in that sense, I think REITs is something that really helps us to cushion
yeah,
our
in
risk
a way.
In
yes,
that sense,
yes,
right?
Definitely.
Yeah, yeah. But one thing interesting about REITs is that it's also good enough to make you live out of it. I've heard people who are retired actually just invested in REITs and they just take the dividend and live off it.
Yeah, right? Exactly. If you have a very big capital to start or retire with, why not? Yeah.
Mm. So do you think that now is a good time to... Do you think that during this recession period or like talking of a recession coming, right? Do you think it's good for people to explore or go into the REITs market?
In my opinion, in my personal opinion, it's definitely nothing. It's definitely a good thing to start to study about REITs because it's easy to understand business model. It pays good dividends. So whether it is the time to enter REITs, I would say you need to do more research into the business itself, into the price action, into the charts itself to really tell if this REIT or some of these REITs that are looking at is really a good time to enter.
Mm. Yes. So one thing before we go,
yes.
I just want to ask you this one thing, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Many people have been talking about like after the Hong Kong thing happening, right?
Mm-hmm.
Many of the Hongkies who are very rich, they started shifting their investment to Singapore. And
mm-hmm.
that led to a very big boom in Singapore REITs lately,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And they say that because Singapore is so crowded right now, they're actually spilling off quite a bit of the money to Malaysia. Yeah. What do you think about that?
I've not personally looked into this, but I think, well, money flows just like water. So if it doesn't go this way, it's definitely gonna go other way. So I would say definitely money inflow into a country, into Malaysia in particular, is definitely good for the market, yes.
Okay, so last thing, just before I go, which is your favorite REIT?
Personally, right now, I would say in 2019, my personal REIT is YTL REIT. It's a hospitality REIT that owns and runs hotels.
Hmm.
But in 2020, I'm looking, other than YTL REITs, I'm also looking into IGB REIT. Personally, and also our target as well.
Why YTL and IGB?
IGB is a pretty, if you look into the numbers, they are pretty fundamentally solid and stable business. So tell me if you can look for parking in Mi Valley. But and YTL REIT is one of the very unique hotel hospitality REITs in Malaysia, where they have business overseas in Australia and Japan as well.
Mm.
And the way they organize their business, if you look into a financial report, it's very unique and it's very special. So do some research on that, you'll find some of the very good nuggets in this company.
Right, that's a good tip. Yeah. So for me myself, my personal favorite is still our Aka.
Mm-hmm.
Because the fact that it is defensive,
mm-hmm.
extremely defensive, and Malaysia has voted one of the top best healthcare tourism
yes.
country in the world, and therefore KPJ, safe, good.
Definitely in my watch list. Yes.
Yeah, that's definitely one of my favorite ones. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I'll look into YTL after what you say.
Yeah.
And yes, YTL is interesting because all over the world they have hotel businesses,
mm-hmm.
and all of it is high class hotel businesses, if I'm not wrong.
Exactly.
Yeah. So these are the few things that we have for today in regards of REITs. I hope you guys enjoyed this episode today in Money Talk, that you learned about real estate investment trust. Now, below in this description as well, I'll attach the link of No Money La for you guys to check out some of his articles and about REITs investment. And also, he should be organizing a workshop.
Yeah, so since 2019, I've been constantly organizing workshops to share my thoughts and research about REITs so people can start to get to know more and invest in REITs. So I'm planning a workshop again sometime in March 2020 or April 2020. So if you are interested, I think be sure to check it out. I think I'll share the link to.
It'll be down there, so we'll put it there. Okay, and nonetheless, if all of you, any one of you have any question about REITs investment, do leave it in the comment below and we'll try our best to answer you. So that's all for today. Thank you very much for watching Money Talk.